My name's Sarah Ann Kelly and I am the local studies officer for Fife. Well, I've always been a librarian. I decided when I was 11 that was what I wanted to do. And my mum said, well, go to the careers office and make sure that you're doing the right thing. So I went along to a careers fair and they said, well, there are three ways you can do it. You can do a postgrad if you do a different degree. And I thought, all right, well, I like my French at school. I want to go and live in France for a year, so I'll go and do a French degree and then do a postgrad. And for some reason, I was able to do that. I managed to do that from the age of 11. I was thinking, this is what I want to do. And I must be one of the very rare people that actually gets to do what they decided when they were 11. And I'm very, very lucky. And I still love it now. I'm 56, you know, so it's been a good job. My big thing is access, giving people access to documents and photographs and getting them digitised to get them to them in the easiest way possible. So they're not sitting on a shelf unused. They're actually available to people and they can get at them the best way they want to. So either it could be film or they could be listening to a podcast or whatever it is. The stories need to be told, need to get out there. So where I'm from, I'm trying to find out about Keelman on the Tyne. That's one of my family history discoveries, was that I've got a family of Keelmen, but the records are so hard to find. But it would make my grandma's day if I could have found that while she was alive, you know, to know that he was a fully signed up Keelman and all of that kind of thing. But I think knowing where you're from and where you come from as well, not just your family but the place that you come from, is extremely valuable to people, to make them feel wanted and worthy and to make them happy. Yeah, you know, you can, if you're proud of the place you come from as well, you want to know its history, and it's great when we can help people find that out, you know. Sometimes they find out stories they don't want to know, and that can be quite emotional, but most people are just delighted to find out things about their own personal history, because people can't take that away from them. You can't change your personal history, but if you can find out what's happened, then it can be quite exciting, and it can explain quite a lot of things in your own life as well. So I think it's a really useful thing to do.
Now, this is an important bit. The country park actually is within Fife Regional Park, which begins from Glen Craig and covers a vast area right up to the Loman Hills, over to Leslie and Mark Inch. It's quite an area, and it also takes in the path, the coastal path. And the charity that's in charge of maintaining that is the Fife Coast and Countryside Trust. They also have a responsibility within Lahore Meadows Country Park. The main reason, and as I say, this is the most important bit in my opinion, the main reason for the creation of this beautiful park was for the deprivation that the local community had suffered for so long. It was a coop. It was a local tipping area for household goods. There were actually a railway run from the Mary Pit to the Aiken Pit with coal, and there were a lot of waste from the pit had actually piled in to the loch. But wasn't it just the pits that scarred? There were wagon loads from factories came and disposed of their waste into the loch. The bottom of the loch is bound to be, I don't know what it'll be like. I'm not into the diving and I'm not going to take a chance to have a look. But that is the main reason within our community that park was created. Now I just want to finish to give you an idea of some characters that lived within the Benarty community. It was quite rough. In fact, something that was very rough. But the first one I've got down here that comes to mind was a man called Paddy Glynn. Local character. Paddy liked a drink and they liked a gamble. There was a famous Dawson school behind the Bings at Glen Craig Pit. A Dawson school where some people won't know what a Dawson school is, but it was a school that was organised and made up by miners, where they took two old pennies and tossed them in the air, and the bets were so much a pound, no, it wouldn't be a pound in the 80s, it would be half a crown or five bob on the land, heads or tails, or head and a tail. So they put the money on what the pennies were going to drop. They also had lookouts, because it was against the law. Some of the younger boys in their teens would set up the bing and give them the wire if the police were coming on the scene, and they would all skedaddle. They were running their bings, jumping their burns, what have you. But Paddy, one day, while making his way to this place, he came across a miner's packet, a wage packet, on opening this. To his dismay, the miner had only done three shifts. Paddy would say that week, the lazy BB, the lazy so-and-so, words to the effect. On one occasion, the same man was sleeping sound in his bed in a close after being thrown out his house, oblivious to the world. Paddy's wife had a hard time, and she would probably throw him out with the bed and the clothes. It was unbelievable, which is a true story, by the way.
I mean, I grew up in Blingary, which is one of the four villages that make up Benarty. So I was born in the house that my mum died in, grew up there. But my mum and dad always put huge emphasis on education. So me and my huge family, there was seven kids, I'm the second youngest of seven. If anybody's going to get better themselves and get out of there, they put huge emphasis on education. And I have to say, me and all my brothers and sisters, we did do that. There was no getting it to play with your pals until your homework was done. But we all flew, and for me, I ended up down in London and working in central government down there. And I always swore when I left, I'd never come back. I'd never come back to Scotland. If I did, it wouldn't be Fife. And if it was, it wouldn't be Benarty. And here I am, I'm literally living 100 yards from the house that I was born in. But what's kept me here are the people that make up our community. They are absolutely fabulous. They chip in. I'll just give you two examples of that. One of them was during the pandemic, and another group sprung up, the Benarty Emergency Response Team, and half of them were on the phones, and it was 9 till 9, 9 in the morning till 9 at night. And people could phone up, order groceries, and then there was another team that drove out to pick them up and deliver to them to the people. Another one stemming from the pandemic, it was one of our drivers. He was aware as he was delivering stuff that obviously there's kids stuck indoors with nowhere to go, nothing to do, driving their parents mad. So he thought, right, we're going to start a wee competition. And he made some bird boxes. And as he was doing his deliveries, he was leaving bird boxes. And the idea was that the kids would paint them, decorate them. They were left on his doorstep, you know, when they were out for their 1 hour exercise. And he put them all up around the country park. And those bird boxes are now obviously getting used. And it also gave the kids an excuse when they're out for their fresh air, a bit of purpose, trying to find their bird box. And then went on to painting stones. Then he introduced fairy doors. And by this time, local businessman's involved. And he said, I'll make your fairy doors for you. So he produced, God knows how many hundreds of fairy doors. And then we had actual fairy cutouts. And Derek Davidson's his name. He then put them all up in this wood that, frankly, we just took over. in the country park. although I did go get permission, we did do the diplomatic thing eventually and go through Fife Council and get permission. But that's all up there. He started a crowd fundraiser, and the amount of people that subscribed to that fundraiser from the local community, because they loved it, they absolutely bought into the idea. Thousands got raised for that. Huge carved archway was built for an entrance to the wood. Local craftsmen were designing their own toadstools, were taking old clumps of wood and everything and taking them away, carving them, and then Derek would open his door and all of a sudden there's a giant mushroom sitting there or whatever it was. People making fairy houses, and oh, just absolutely fabulous. And we've got other huge carvings there now. Now, all right, it took one man to start it, but the rate of buy-in for ordinary people, not involved with any voluntary groups, sharing their time, their skill, their craft, absolutely fabulous.
My wife, oh, that is a great story. My wife, my wife actually met me for the first time when she was about 14, 15, and I was about 18. And she pulled about with my sister. And I went to my sister's house and she was there. I never even gave her a look, honestly, because she was a wee lassie. Can't she be a pretty wee lassie, but she was a wee lassie. And she says, "I fancy you, big brother." But that was it, there was nothing. Okay? Fast forward a few years later, and she was now maybe early 20s, and I was a wee bit older, you know. I came home on leave, and I went to my sister's house again, and there she was sitting there, absolutely gorgeous. and that night we were all going out to Leslie Club, and I said to her, "Are you coming out with us?" She went, "Oh, yeah, yeah." So I went to Leslie Club and had a great night, and my eyes were on normal, you know. It was. She was gorgeous, you know. She was blonde hair, she had everything, you know, cheekbones and like. So we left the club and went back to my sister's house for a wee party, you know. Yeah. Now my sister had a sister-in-law who was a bit keen on me, you know, sort of thing. I'm sounding a bit big-headed here, but she was more keener on me than I was on her, sort of thing, you know. And she was meant to be with me that night, yeah. But I ended up through the kitchen talking to Norma. So this lassie, Linda, neighbours, she went and slammed the door and walked away, you know. And I said to Norma, I said, "You know something?" I says, "I'm going to marry you someday." I says, "I really am." Now, I was a jack the lad and never even thought about getting married. You know, that was it, you know, 25-year-old or something, you know. But I said that to her, I says, "I'm going to marry you." You know? And it really was a classic example of love at first sight. It really was, you know, that was it. Both of us were smitten. They were absolutely smitten. It was a short time later when I was posted to Belize. So, but we had to book a phone call in these days. No fancy mobiles in these days, yeah. You booked a phone call and was on the phone to her every night, you know. Unfortunately, she fell pregnant before I went to Belize, and she lost the child. I couldn't get back to go through all that. Couldn't get back, you know. Just had a miscarriage, yeah. But I came back from Belize all suntanned, and you know, and before we knew it, we got married. You know, we got married, but I moved to Germany, got a married quarter, and all my children came along, and that was great. I'm very proud of my family as well. Yeah, my family. Angela, who works alongside me, she's building a great reputation as a funeral director herself. You know, so she's been with me every step of the way, on my own business. My son Gary, who gets married in a few weeks' time in Cyprus. Gary was a football player, and I was very proud watching Gary, because I'm football daft. Yeah. Playing for Cowden and Beath, became a professional for a wee while. It was only Cowden and Beath, but he was a professional, and I watched him play against Raith Rovers. And my younger daughter Kirsty, she works in a bank as well. She's pretty bright, you know. She works in Royal Bank of Scotland. So very proud of my family, and you know, and they're all doing great. They've never let me down, put it that way, you know.